see if you can see it, because then last minute I'll have a problem.
Yes, yes, ma'am, you can do
So,
that.
start broadcast. You made me the host, right? Can you see my slides, Payal?
Yeah, I can see it very clearly and it's moving also. So.
It's moving, right? Okay,
Yeah.
so I'll just leave it at this now. This is my presentation. So when you
Okay.
want me to start, I'll start with this thing.
Okay, sure.
Okay, so can I just stay here only, because I don't think, can you see me also? I think you can only see my slides, right?
Yeah, we can only see your slides.
And that is the problem. So what we'll do is we'll have it like this only, and
Okay.
when you want me to start, then I'll start sharing. So I'll just require half a minute. Okay.
Okay, ma'am. Yeah.
Thank you.
Good evening, doctors. Hi, ma'am. This is Saurabh Sharma from the marketing team, ma'am. Are
Okay.
you able to hear me, ma'am?
Good evening.
Thank you very much, Dr. Payal, ma'am, once again for this webinar. And it's a very new topics, especially we are all interested to understand gut dysbiome and also what is happening, in terms of gut dysbiome in children, and also most importantly, PCOS and infertility subject, which requires everyday refresher. Thank you, ma'am, for such a nice collection of topics today. Ma'am, Dr. Som has already informed you, ma'am, about our process. So we'll just begin. We'll welcome you, and we'll also share our AV, and we'll hand it over to you, ma'am, to Dr. Payal, ma'am. Right, Dr. Som, hi.
Yes, already explained and we'll
Already
start.
6-3 already there, so let's begin.
Yeah. Yes. Good evening, doctors. This is Dr. Someshwar from Shield Healthcare. I welcome you all on behalf of Shield. Thank you very much for joining today's webinar. I request all the participants to post their questions in the comment box, so that we will address at the end of the webinar. And thank you once again for joining today's webinar. And let me welcome today's moderator, Dr. Payal Bhargava, madam. Actually, she doesn't need any introduction. It's an honor to introduce ma'am. Dr. Payal Bhargava, ma'am, she did her post-graduation diploma in ART and reproductive medicine from Kiel, Germany, and fellowship in infertility from IMA Hyderabad, and life member of IMA Menopause Society India, PCOS Society India, member of managing committee of PCOS Society India, co-founder and director on board XPS Analytics Private Limited, and consultant at Sri Krishna Diagnostic Center, consultant at Pranada Hospital PFPA Hyderabad, co-founder Divine Magic Foundation, a public health and awareness initiative working at grassroots level and digitally through its YouTube channel. Thank you, ma'am. And before proceeding for the webinar, we have a short AV, I mean web page launch of Shield Connect. I request Venkatakrishnan to Venkat, could you please share the Shield Connect? Yeah, this is the Shield Connect web page where regarding today's our speakers web page. We have created like this for the all the speakers for most of the doctors, and you can find their the biography as well as their webinars and also their past and upcoming webinars, as well as we have also created a blogs page where you can see the blogs written by most of the fellow doctors in the medical fraternity. And also we have created one more page regarding PCOS awareness page, and it is available in all the regional languages, and this is for the patient education and awareness. And also we have one more page that is our leaders, where you can find all the supporting doctors and the key speakers and the key opinion leaders who are supporting scientifically through Shield Connect. And thank you, and I request all the delegates to please go through Shield Connect webpage and see the all the scientific related information and webinars. Yeah, and I request Dr. Payal Bhargava to take over to moderate the webinar.
Thank you so much. Can you share the CV of the speakers, please?
Sure, ma'am.
Good evening, everyone. Today's webinar, I have chosen all my favorite topics, which is much need of the hour. So our first speaker today is Dr. Sandhya Saharan, ma'am. She is consultant, obstetrician, and gynecologist with special interest in endoscopy, infertility, and yoga. She is consultant in Jupiter Hospital, Thane, LH Hiranandani, IVF and Birthing Hospital. She has received many awards, Young Scientist Award in 1994, recipient of H. Desa Silver Jubilee Award 2001, Best Paper in International Congress on Infertility in 2003, Bharat Jyoti and Best Citizens of India Award 2007, devised nomograms for labor monitoring, Vice President of Thane Obstetrician and Gynec Society. She's Rotarian singer and dramatist. I'm so very happy for her to accept our invitation to do this webinar. Welcome, ma'am. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Payal, and thank you, Sheel, for inviting me for this lovely talk today. It's a topic very close to our hearts because I'm doing a lot of work on PCOS, including a study also right now at Jupiter Hospital. So I'll be very happy to share my talk on PCOS and infertility. If you would give me a moment, I'll just share my slides. But I think, unfortunately, you'll not be able to see me through my talk, which I think is okay because the slides can do the talking. So here we go on. Okay, so I think we can see my screen. Payal, are we, am I audible and visible?
Yes, ma'am, we can see.
Okay, so PCOS and infertility.
Yeah, audible and very clear.
This is a lovely slide, which I just like, you know, it is like the tip of the iceberg where you see the polycystic ovarian syndrome. And you don't know what lies underneath. So only when you start unraveling it, then you can go to the bottom of it. It's like a Pandora's box. It is so many things you don't know. Once you open it, there will be so many things coming out, leaving you completely bewildered, as this slide shows. It has metabolic, reproductive, and multiple implications which require a multi-pronged approach, that is pediatrics, dermatology, gynecology, endocrinology, diabetology, cardiology, and geriatrics. So we have a changing paradigm in PCOS where we have to see that what is the patient's manifestation and what is her complaint, and most importantly, what we need to address in her, whether it is a reproductive outcome, or it is cosmetic, or it is just menstrual irregulation. Now, ESHRI recommendations on PCOS, as we have just mentioned, it is a public health issue. It has a lot of ramifications. One of the most common conditions affecting women, up to 13% of them in the reproductive age group, and 70% even to this day remain undiagnosed because it is a diagnosis of exclusion. So women present with diverse features. It could be just psychological, like anxiety or depression. It could be reproductive, that is irregular menstrual cycles, hirsutism, infertility, or even if they are pregnant, then pregnancy complications, a lot of first trimester losses, metabolic features of insulin resistance, metabolic syndrome, that is obesity, hypertension, type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular risk factors. So now we need this kind of a Bahubali bow and arrow. It is too many arrows, and we can target all the characteristics of PCOS as we see. If it is insulin resistance, it is manifested as hyperinsulinemia or even gestational diabetes, hyperandrogenism as acne and hirsutism, hormonal imbalances in oligo or anovulation, menstrual dysfunctions, metabolic syndrome, central obesity, hypertriglyceridemia, and psychological problems. Like I mentioned, these patients land up with a very poor self-esteem and even manifest with suicidal tendencies. So it is very imperative to diagnose this as well as treat it, instead of just brushing it under the carpet and saying this is something which is going to go by itself. It never goes by itself. It is something which needs lifelong therapy, because PCOS is a disease for the lifetime. Now, we know the basic underlying pathology of PCOS is insulin resistance. Now, this can manifest in many patients, up to 50%. In some patients who are lean PCOS, who are not obese, we may need to do insulin levels. Otherwise, normally they manifest as acanthosis nigricans with striae, or they can have skin tags also. Now, 65 to 70% of these women, they are obese, and the other half may have a normal weight, or they could be having a lean PCOS. Now, what happens in hyperinsulinemia? It causes an increased ovarian theca androgen production. Now, we all know the androgen production, if it supersedes or if it exceeds the estrogen production, there is a predominantly dominance of androgenic features, and they land up with this hirsutism, which is basically excess of terminal hair on the male sexual sites, that is on the chin, the chest, the abdomen. And another thing which is very important is a decreased production of SHBG, that is the sex hormone binding globulin, by the liver. Now, it is this sex hormone binding globulin which is responsible for the excess of circulating free testosterone levels. If there is a decrease in this level, then only the free testosterone levels increase, and they cause an androgen excess, which causes follicular atresia and an ovulation. So basically, hyperandrogenism, hyperinsulinemia is the pathophysiology behind this disease. Now, how do we diagnose it? Over the years, we have heard of so many diagnostic criteria. The first which came in 1990 was by the NIH. Now, this said that all of the following must be there: hyperandrogenism and or hyperandrogenemia, anovulation or oligoovulation, and exclusion of possible related disorders. Now, we'll come to the possible related disorders later. But what it mentions is the presence of polycystic ovaries is not necessary for diagnosis. Now, this is the criteria which was first developed, and it is the most commonly used criteria today. Then we had the Rotterdam consensus in 2003, which said that you should include two of the following: oligo or anovulation, clinical or biochemical signs of hyperandrogenism, and polycystic ovaries. Excuse me. So now, again, it is to rule out the possible other factors which mimic PCOS. The Androgen Excess Society and the PCOS Society requires all of the following: hyperandrogenism, ovarian dysfunction, and exclusion of the possible related criteria. And they emphasize that the diagnosis of PCOS should not be made without evidence of hyperandrogenism. Now, what we have seen is the ESHRAE and the ASRM guidelines for PCOS in 2018. They recommend a redefinition of the ultrasound criteria. They support the Rotterdam criteria, but they say that ultrasound assessment is not necessary in patients who have both irregular cycles and hyperandrogenism. And they said that ultrasound is only necessary to identify the full PCOS phenotype. Now, we all know that we have such good quality transducers with high resolution frequency. Initially, it was said that PCOS is defined when there is either 12 or more follicles in each or both ovaries measuring 2 to 9 millimeters in diameter. Now, the latest guidelines have revised this cutoff to more than or equal to 20 in adult ovary in each or either ovary. So this is something which we need to remember, that it is the polycystic ovarian morphology which is holding importance today. Now, this is what we are reiterated in this slide. The other important features as the raised LH to FSH ratio, insulin resistance and obesity remains the same. And it is just the emphasis on the PCOM, that is the morphology on ultrasound. Now, with all these things, we are faced with a diagnostic dilemma, as well as how do you differentiate from the other diseases. Like I said, there are certain diseases which mimic PCOS. The most importantly, we have the thyroid. The thyroid and the prolactin. Now, we all know these along with the growth hormone. They work in synchrony and they have, along with the follicle stimulating hormone, are responsible for recruiting the follicle, which grows and is responsible for ovulation. Now, if there is hypothyroidism, so you can measure it, you can either do a free T3, T4 and TSH level, or not necessarily a free T3, T4, just normal T3, T4, TSH is also all right. So this is one thing which you need to know. The problem with thyroid is we are seeing a lot, many cases of hypothyroidism, and there is always a dilemma when you have a patient with a value between 4 and 6, because as per the guidelines, the treatment should be initiated only when the TSH is about 10. Unless and until it is between 6 and 10 associated with the presence of antibodies. So in those cases, you have to look for immunoglobulins and TPO antibodies. Otherwise, it is just wait and watch, repeat. And only if it is fitting into that, then you start with thyroid medication. And the second is hyperprolactinemia. Now, this is something which we see very often in our patients. They may or may not manifest with galactorrhea. And many a times, they come with a lot of menstrual irregularities and amenorrhea also. So prolactin levels are very important. The other emerging trend is that of diminished ovarian reserve or ovarian failure. By definition, premature ovarian failure is when there is cessation of menstruation by the age of 30. But nowadays, with the advent of these pandemics and a lot of stress which has crept into society and environmental issues, we are seeing not many women with diminished ovarian reserve. Now, the best indicator of an ovarian reserve is the AMH level, which tells us what is her follicular status. This should always be combined with an antral follicle count when you are looking at a patient with infertility, because that gives you an assessment of how this patient is going to respond to assisted reproductive techniques. One thing which we should remember is AMH levels, by and large on their own, do not tell you whether the patient will conceive or not. It is not an indicator of her reproductive potential. It just tells you whether she will respond favorably to treatment or not. Sometimes I have seen patients with AMH as low as 0.7 and they conceive within the first cycle itself. So this is something which has to be very delicately handled and you have to put it across to patients. Mostly in PCOS, the AMH levels are very high and with just recombinant FSH, we can lower down the AMH levels very, very well. Now, why these AMH levels are high? Because of the chronic anovulation, there is inhibition of the initial recruitment of the primordial follicles, which causes a follicular arrest. Now, this, what happens is, when you give FSH, then there is a stimulated growth of the large follicles and they lose their AMH expression. So the AMH levels come down, you tend to get a better follicle, you can get ovulation and patient may conceive. So that is the rationale behind doing an AMH level as well as the treatment for the same. Now, congenital adrenal hyperplasia, that is the late onset ones, we all know that there is an enzyme called 21-hydroxylase. If it is deficient, then these patients can manifest with CAH and it can be measured with doing 17 OHP levels. Now, Cushing's syndrome is something which we see not so often. It causes amenorrhea, obesity, hirsutism, and acne. And it can be diagnosed by doing a dexamethasone suppression test, ACTH levels. We can give 1 milligram of dexamethasone at dinner time and followed by the serum cortisol levels at 8 a.m. in the morning. And if they are raised, then we can say that she could be having a Cushing's syndrome. Very rarely we see androgen secreting tumors and severe insulin resistance that basically can be manifesting with amenorrhea or very high obesity, BMI of almost more than 35 also. Now, fasting insulin is something which we do not do largely for all patients. It is only in patients who are not having overt insulin resistance, who do not have any clinical characteristics, where we do, especially in lean PCOS. Otherwise, the Endocrine Society largely says that fasting insulin is obsolete and it is not done to diagnose PCOS as such. It is not in the armamentarium. We can do a 75 grams OGTT in these patients, especially if they are very apprehensive because PCOS is linked to type 2 diabetes. So that is something which we have to keep in mind. Even FSH and LH levels are not routinely done for diagnosing PCOS. So these are some things which can be done only when you want to rule out ovarian failures or hyperprolactinemia, thyroid deficiencies. And what we stress, especially in adolescent PCOS and those who have hirsutism, you can do a testosterone level. So now what is recommended is a calculated free testosterone level. It is not something like, you know, that you just do as testosterone because the radioimmunoassays are not standardized. So it is not easy to do a testosterone level and label a patient. A biochemical hyperandrogenism is only if you can see a calculated free testosterone more than 100 or if you have a free androgen index. This should be done only when you have seen that the androstenedione and the DHEAS levels, they are not very high. That is, DHEAS is done only when you are suspecting an androgen secreting tumor because it is largely secreted only by the adrenals. Now, clinical examination is the mainstay, as I said. Most of these tests are not necessarily done if you can overtly see hyperandrogenism. That is, hirsutism, the male pattern of hair on the secondary sexual sites or a hair loss and acne. If these are present, then there is really no need to do all these expensive tests. Then we just start the treatment by and large. Now, biochemical, as I said, only when the testosterone levels are not elevated, then we go on to further tests like the DHEAS. I have hardly done a DHEAS level in the last 30 years, maybe only in a very few patients where we need to exclude any other cause. Now, AMH levels, like I told you, how they have a rationale, I've already explained. Now, what are the implications? The metabolic, endocrine, reproductive manifestations, as we have just seen, the increased testosterone levels, androstenedione, decreased SHBG, increased insulin and an increased LH-FSH ratio with dyslipidemias. These have a lot of repercussions on the reproductive potential. And we also see the symptomatology. It can be oligomenorrhea, secondary amenorrhea, anovulation, infertility, and early pregnancy loss. Now, these next two slides more or less summarize my entire talk. So I will take some time and just go to them slowly so that, you know, we don't have to repeat everything again. As the talk is basically addressing infertility. So this is a very good algorithm. These are all from the latest ESHRE and ASRM guidelines, which have been released in 2018-19. So the first mainstay of PCOS, even if you are going to treat infertility, is you have to assess the patient if she is obese, what is her menstrual status, and exactly what is her timeline. If she is obese, then first we do is a non-pharmacological management. Lifestyle modification cannot be stressed more. Any patient who has a waist-hip ratio of more than 0.8 or a BMI of more than 25 should be advised to lose weight. Now, the rationale behind this is even a 5% reduction in weight causes resumption of normal menstruation and ovulation. And many a times, this is itself enough in the patient getting pregnant very soon. So that is one thing which you have to emphasize and you have to drive home to the patient. There is no shortcut. You have to exercise, and diet and exercise concomitantly work the best. Lifestyle modification is the key to any management of PCOS. Now, letrozole. Initially, it wasn't available, so it was an issue, but now it is available. So it should be considered as the pharmacological first line of treatment. Only when there is anovulation in spite of letrozole. Now we go on to clomiphene citrate. Initially, we were giving clomiphene only in patients when we did not have letrozole. We do have good results with clomiphene even today. But if patients are not responding and anovulation persists, then it should be coupled with metformin, because in combination, they give a definitely better result in ovulation as well as a take-home pregnancy rate. Metformin alone can be used in patients whose BMI is more than 25. But in patients who have an extremely high BMI, more than 35, it is not very useful. When the insulin levels are high, we all know metformin is an insulin sensitizer. It reduces the insulin levels, increases the hepatic uptake of glucose, and lowers the circulating testosterone, as well as it causes ovulation. So this is a very, very important drug. What is necessary is to explain to the patient that this is a diabetic drug, because many patients come and complain, especially if they are very young, that doctor, you prescribed me a diabetes medication. So you have to tell them why you are doing it, because these are not generally, they are off-label in PCOS. So everything has to be documented and explained to the patient. And just giving metformin for 2 or 3 months is really not enough. It should be given for at least 6 months. Only then you start seeing the results. And later on, we'll go on to gonadotropins, but this is how the management goes. It is the second line of treatment only when all this is not working. And so is laparoscopic ovarian drilling. Now, laparoscopic ovarian surgery, if you are doing it for any other cause, suppose you are going to do it for just a diagnostic laparoscopy to assess the tubal patency. Now, tubal patency is something which should absolutely be documented. We cannot go on to treatment for infertility without seeing the tubal status. If the patient is not willing for a laparoscopy, at least a hysterosalpingography or a sonosalpingography to see the tubal patency. Otherwise, you go on to step 4. You may even think of just considering IVF, and then you realize that you've not assessed the tubal patency. So that is really something, especially in our country when we have so much of tuberculosis and we have hydrosalpings, we have tubal blocks. We should keep this in mind and do a tubal patency. So this is basically just the outline of the workup. Non-fertility indications are basically in patients who are very young or adolescents and who are very troubled by their anovulation as well as infrequent menstruation or irregular cycles. So combined oral contraceptive pills work in those patients. A very low dose of 20 micrograms can go on to 30. Now, this is definitely for patients who are not looking at fertility. So I will not go into the details, but there are patients who are very distressed by the hirsutism. So we have to keep in mind therapy for this also. And therapy should be for 6 months in hirsutism, along with you can combine it with cyproterone acetate. In the US, cyproterone acetate is not available. They mainly use spironolactone, but we have the benefit of this therapy also. So you can give these along with, you have to consider of giving them something which will reduce their weight if they are obese. So metformin is very important. I personally also like inositols. I am a very strong proponent of myo-inositols because I feel that they are equally useful in insulin sensitization. But of course, many studies are still underway and there is going to be a large group which is going to come out with a database which is going to highlight the efficacy of inositols. So it is entirely up to you which kind of drug which you like to comfortably give to the patient, and you have equally good responses with any of these. So combined orals, contraceptive pills, lifestyle modifications, metformin or inositols. You have a lot of anti-obesity drugs, medications which can be considered. Especially patients find it very difficult to lose weight. It is very easy to just say lose weight, but very difficult to do so. So definitely some amount of help is achieved with giving these medications, but you have to choose correctly. It should not be a one size fits all. So only when the patient is unable to lose weight in spite of lifestyle modifications, then anti-obesity medications can be prescribed. And in very, very resistant cases, we think of bariatric surgery. So now these are the slides which show you that how is the armamentarium of the infertility workup, that is clomipene citrate, letrozole, no ovulation, maximum 4 to 6 cycles. And metformin, not more than 2000 milligrams per day, plus clomiphene or alone. And again, no ovulation, then you go on to the second line of therapy, that is gonadotropins. And if nothing works, then you have to consider IVF. Now I said like letrozole should be the first line of treatment, and it improves the ovulation, pregnancy, live birth rates. Now it is an insulin sensitizer, similar to inositols, reduces the insulin resistance and inhibits hepatic glucose production, reduces weight, centripetal obesity, and improves menstrual frequency and restores ovulation. The same inositols, they also work on the same principle, and it is absolutely an individual choice, and we have a lot of good results coming from both these medications. Now, when do you use CC along with metformin and only CC or only metformin? All this has been explained. And only in patients when the BMI is more than 35, then there is not much of benefit seen, as it is reiterated by the Fertility Sterility Journal in 2008. Now, the duration we have seen at least 3 to 6 months of therapy is important. Giving it only for 2 or 3 months has absolutely no rationale. And we see that the results start showing only after 6 months in many patients. Now, gonadotropins, as I said, should be considered as the second line, but we have to remember that they are expensive and they can cause multiple pregnancy. So gonadotropins have to be monitored. You have to do ovulation induction. If you are doing studies, you have to do the follicle studies and see whether you're landing up in OHSS. That is very important with gonadotropins and it should be monitored very stringently. Now, IVF, as we all know, when everything fails, then you look at IVF. Now, there are so many, there are step-up protocols, there are step-down protocols, there are innumerable protocols. So we'll not go into the intricacies of IVF as we are going short of time also. But that is something which you can offer to your patient as a last resort when everything fails, if you have done 4 to 6 cycles of IUI, then there is really no point in waiting, because these patients have only so many eggs. If you are going to exhaust all their ovarian reserve, then you may land up with donor eggs. So it's better that, you know, you decide when to put a stop and when to think of IVF. So this is something which we can offer. We have a lot of things today. Now, lifestyle management, weight reduction, as I have already mentioned, that it decreases the insulin levels and the androgen production. Everything, even the symptoms, acanthosis, the blood sugars, everything normalizes in the patient. So avoid processed food, fried food. Go on to more complex carbs like oatmeals and eat more of whole grains and vegetables, and also eat sensibly. Caloric count is the bottom line. You reduce your calories, the weight is going to come down. So all the good aspects of weight loss, that is protection against diabetes and the cardiovascular disease, everything is an outcome of a decent weight loss program. Bariatric surgery is only as a last resort when everything else, behavioral therapy, drug intervention, fails after 6 months. Now, this is a very nice, I like these a lot. They are my favorite. And diet and weight loss. Did you know diet stands for did I eat that? So these are my favorite ones. And I think all I have lost is 14 days in 2 weeks if you follow a stringent diet. Now, the basis of newer drugs, we all know, is to reduce the oxidative stress, which is important in the pathogenesis of PCOS. So the summary of the review of literature shows that melatonins, acetylcysteines, myoinositols, alpha-calcidol, and methylfolate, all of them have some function in improving the ovarian function quality, improving the insulin sensitivity, decreasing the free testosterone, reduces hirsutism, acne, and weight, and reduces the homocysteine levels and prevents cardiovascular risk factor. So this is what we have to offer, and definitely we can give the patient a decent outcome, fertility-wise, and also resumption of regular menstruation. Thank you so much for a patient hearing, and I hope that I have put across the message. If there are any questions, I would like to take them. Payal, thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sandhya, for explaining with so much simplicity such an enigmatic topic and emphasizing on lifestyle modifications. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. I know you could not see me on, but I think that's okay.
So our next speaker for today is Dr. Meera. Can I have a CV, please? Dr. Meera is DGO, MS, Obstetrics and Gynec from Safdarganj Hospital, New Delhi. She has done her DNB, FNB Reproductive Medicine from Oasis Fertility Hyderabad. She is co-founder of MAM Academy, New Delhi. She has special interest in PCOS, male infertility, and high-risk pregnancy. She has more than 20 publications in scientific journals. She is editorial board member of Indian Journal of Case Reports. Welcome, Dr. Meera. You have to unmute yourself. Dr. Meera, we are not able to hear you.
Doctor, can you see your laptop's volume, ma'am? Can you increase that? Dr. Meera, ma'am? KVK, can you help in this?
Yeah, sure. 1 minute. Ma'am, can you just click up arrow in unmute area? So you have more options. There you have to select same as system. So under select a microphone and under select a speaker, so you have options as same as a system. Can you just select that? No, ma'am, not audible.
Okay, we can use any desk then.
Yes. Can you just come to any desk, ma'am? Just download any desk, ma'am, from Google.
Ma'am, refer to the chat, ma'am. I have text you, ma'am. Okay, we can put everything in the chat box.
Okay.
Hi, Dr. Murtaza here. I think I'll start till then Dr. Meera can see that.
Yeah, I think sure. That's better. That's yeah.
Better.
Yeah. So KVK, what you do is you talk to the doctor directly, okay, and solve for this.
Sure, I'll talk to her over phone and solve this.
Can I have the slide of Dr. Murtaza, please? Dr. Dr. Murtaza is MD Pediatrics from Safdarganj Hospital, New Delhi. He has done his DNB in Pediatrics, DNB Super Speciality Pediatric Cardiology from Stars Hospital, Hyderabad, Principal Consultant Pediatric Cardiology and Pediatrics, RNR Hospital and Kamal Hospital, Jhunjhun, Rajasthan. More than 50 publications in journals of scientific repute. He has special interest in pediatric cardiology, adolescent medicine, and neonatology. He is an invited speaker in both national and international conferences. He has won Best Paper Award in IP 2013 in pediatrics and Best Paper Award in CSI 2018 in cardiology. He has a wonderful YouTube channel dedicated to patients as well as young doctors. Welcome, Dr. Murtaza.
Thank you, Dr. Payal, for the nice introduction, and thank you, Shield Connect, for this, giving me the opportunity. I'll just share my screen. Is it seen? Can you see my screen?
Yes, it is very clear. Just make it full screen.
Just. Good evening, everyone. There has been a lot of talk about dysbiosis in children. So that will be a wide topic, and I will be confining myself to dysbiosis in children born by cesarean section. That will be a topic of interest maybe for now, and later we can discuss about dysbiosis in children as a whole, which will take much longer time. So what basically is the need of this talk today? The data of NHFS-4 says that C-section rates have increased in the last 10 years from 8.5% in 2005-06 to up to 17.2% in 2015-16. While the CDC data says that in 2017, more than 30% of the total deliveries have been by C-section in the United States. So there has been a steep rise in the C-section delivery rates, which makes it imperative to understand the potential of microbiota modulation for the treatment of dysbiosis. So the purpose of my talk will be to present the current understanding of both the microbial risk factors that increases the likelihood of a C-section delivery and the microbial dysbiosis that is thought to result from the C-section. So we will see the risk factors which increases the likelihood of a C-section delivery, and also what the dysbiosis does to those kids who are born by C-section. Because we all are aware that those kids which are born by C-section, they have a different microbial flora from those which are born vaginally. It's a known fact that the gut microbiota plays a critical role in the infant immune and metabolic development. The mode of delivery is a major determinant of early life exposure and colonization of the gut of kids. We all are aware when the child is in utero, the GI tract is essentially uncolonized. It is sterile. So the exposure to microbes during delivery and to the environment immediately following birth is the key to the establishment of microbiota. The vaginally derived infants are colonized with microbes like Lactobacillus, Provotella, Bacteroides, Escherichia, Bifidobacterium. And these have been identified from the vaginal and the fecal samples from adult mothers. So this, we will see that this microbiota is very much different from those which will be born by cesarean delivery. In these vaginally born, Lactobacillus is the one which predominates, which is present in the vagina. With regards to C-section and microbes, the microbial dysbiosis during pregnancy is often associated with complications which can indicate C-section delivery, such as a preterm birth, extremes of maternal BMI, infection, extremes of infant size, and gestational diabetes. Birth via C-section interrupts the normal pattern of microbial colonization, because those kids which are born by C-section, they are no longer exposed to the maternal vagina or the enteric microbes during their birth. These kids which are born by C-section are dominated by the human skin and the oral bacteria, which includes mainly staph and strep, and the others can be propionibacterium, corynebacterium, and valionella. Whereas those which were born by vagina, we saw that lactobacillus is the one which predominates, because that was the one which was present in the vagina and the gut. Whereas those which are born with CS, the skin flora and the oral bacterial flora is the one which mainly predominates in their gut. And we all are aware now, a lot of studies are there from the last, I think from 10-15 years, we have a lot of studies which are associating the gut microbiota with the diseases. And we are aware that this gut microbiota is intimately associated with training the innate immune system of a neonate. And its disruption in the early life can result in infections, sepsis, and systemic immune and metabolic disorders, which influences the lifelong disease risk. Microbial dysbiosis caused by C-section delivery has been associated with an increased risk of long-term disease conditions of the kid, like asthma, obesity, allergies, mainly food allergies, type 1 diabetes, systemic connective tissue disorders, juvenile arthritis, inflammatory bowel disease, and leukemias. So we have a hell of a lot of diseases which have been associated with microbial dysbiosis, and these have been found, studies are there, literature is present, which shows that those kids born by C-section, they have more risks of having these conditions. So maternal microbiome is affected by antibiotic treatment, periodontal disease, and smoking status, and it has been tied to the adverse pregnancy outcomes. This is a known fact, and we all are aware of this. So what basically are the causes of cesarean section and confounding factors? The complications that can indicate cesarean section delivery, such as preterm birth, extremes of maternal BMI, infections, infant size, its extremes, gestational diabetes, these are often associated with microbial dysbiosis during pregnancy. And the indications for cesarean section, these indications for cesarean section may themselves have an impact on the microbiota, and therefore they confound our understanding of the microbiota of the cesarean section delivery, because these factors will themselves have some impact on the microbiota per se. So they will create a confounding factor for understanding the clear-cut role of microbiota in cesarean section delivery. This is a slide which is showing the indications of the cesarean section, like we have preterm birth, gestational diabetes, extremes of maternal BMI, extremes of infant size, and infection, and the immune response is occurring in them. And we see that long-term diseases, health outcomes are affecting the kids, like inflammatory bowel disease, autoimmune conditions, asthma, allergy, metabolic disorders, type 1 diabetes, etc. So coming to the preterm birth as a special case, we all are aware that preterm neonates are more likely to be delivered by cesarean section, and this reduces their exposure to the maternal vaginal and the enteric microbes. This results in differential immune system development, which can shape the microbial colonization in their already immature guts. So they are also subjected to higher rates of formula feeding, invasive procedures, antibiotics, and other medications which alter their GIP pH, which contributes to the altered assembly of microbial community. These preterms, they usually are NICU graduates, they have long NICU stays, and this creates a lot of antibiotic resistant genes and bacteria in their gut and the body. So this also contributes to their microbiome. There is no single cause of preterm birth identified till date, and the risk factors are multiple, which involves microbial dysbiosis, which includes ascending urogenital infections, descending periodontal infections, abnormal vaginal microbiota. There are other conditions which are resulting in increased rates of C-section delivery, which includes extremes of maternal BMI, infections, gestational diabetes, and infant size. We should be aware that high maternal BMI is not solely attributed to the genetic factors, as we always say that it is due to genetic factors and environmental factors, but it also is due to the microbial composition, because the gut microbial dysbiosis can affect the nutrient absorption, inflammation, and microbial translocations, as well as fetal gut colonization and the development of fetal metabolic tissues. So high maternal BMI is not solely attributed to genetic and environmental factors, but these microbes also have a role in that. Coming to the long-term health outcomes of C-section, so the children which are born by C-section, they have immune and metabolic health, those are affected. They can have GI outcomes, diseases including the inflammatory bowel diseases, risk of atopy and allergies, including asthma, atopic dermatitis, eczema, etc., and metabolic syndrome. These are the long-term sequelae. Coming to the immune and the metabolic health, C-section delivered infants have increased risk of type 1 diabetes, inflammatory bowel disease, and autoimmune and allergic conditions. And evidence is there in the form of multiple studies, which imply that early events may dictate immune abnormalities that increases the risk for diseases later in life. We all are aware that a lot of antibiotics nowadays over the counter are used during pregnancy, prior to and immediately preceding C-section delivery to prevent infections. And since in our country over the counter drugs are very easily available, no one needs a prescription nowadays. In lot of parts of our country to get the medicines, so antibiotic access is easily available to everyone, and it is used even during pregnancy by many of the people. There are non-culture based studies which are available of adult intestinal microbiomes, which shows that antibiotic exposure may perturb the GI tract microbiota for years, and microbial perturbations in the GI tract have been associated with Crohn's disease. There was a Danish study which was done in between 1976 to 1996, in which 8,000 inflammatory bowel disease people were diagnosed before the age of 36 years, and controlling for the genetic predisposition, the second most major cause was the C-section delivery. So the most common cause for this, for IBD in people who were less than 36 years, was of course genetic factor, but the second most common was in those people who were born by C-section delivery. Furthermore, a majority of the IBD people, IBD diagnosis occurred after the age of 15, implying that dysbiosis from C-section delivery at the beginning of the life may have a long-term health implications also. So there is an increased risk of atopy and allergic diseases in these, and it has been shown that these kids have those born by C-section, they have a lot of food allergies, and an infant's odds of developing allergy is influenced by multiple, by feeding mode also, which includes breastfeeding versus formula feeding, which represents the first nutrition related microbes entering into the human body. Therefore, feeding mode plays an important role in exposure to and response to food allergens in early development of gut microbiota. Coming to the metabolic syndrome, maternal BMI may be a determinant of infant gut microbial community over lactation. And breast milk from these obese mothers tend to contain a distinct and less diverse microbial community compared with milk from the normal weight women. So the breast milk of those females who have a higher BMI is quite different in the microbiota content from those which are of normal weight women. Breast milk microbiota also differs between mothers who delivered by cesarean section versus vaginally, which could be due to surgery or physiological stress or hormonal stress signals. So even the breast milk microbiota is different in the two cases. Northern Manhattan study was done in children and kids and their mother, in which a total of 436 mom-child diets were taken and they were followed up to 7 years. They showed that children exposed to antibiotics during the second and third trimesters of pregnancy of their mother, they had a higher, up to 84% higher risk of obesity in those. So even those children who were affected by antibiotics, who were exposed to antibiotics, during their second or third trimester, and in their follow-up of 7 years, they have shown that they are largely at the risk of developing obesity in long term. So coming to the restoration therapy to infants, so what can we actually do to restore the therapies of microbiota in these? So a perturbed infant gut microbiota may be returned to a baseline state either through the reintroduction of commensal bacteria along with breastfeeding and or through pre-probiotic formulations. Till now, US FDA is yet to approve any pre-probiotic formulation to treat the microbial dysbiosis caused by C-section delivery. We do not have approval till date for any pre or probiotic formulations, but studies are there which are working into this field. There is an ongoing clinical trial in the UK which is investigating whether short-term daily probiotic supplementation with bifidobacterium in breastfed babies born by C-section promotes a healthy fetal microbiota that can be maintained with breastfeeding until 6 months of age. So they are basically supplementing these kids which are born by C-section delivery and are being breastfed with bifidobacterium. And they are doing this till 6 months of age. And they are seeing the short-term and long-term outcomes of these. This study is still going on. There are US FDA trials which are testing the safety and efficacy of pre-probiotics that targets illnesses associated with C-section delivery. Like long-term illnesses they are targeting, like early life supplementation with lactobacillus, GG, in infants with high risk of asthma. This is already in trial and many companies have already started making in this, and a lot of medical representatives are now approaching us with this in our daily practice. The second approach which is now coming is like in experimental form is vaginal seeding. This is a new strategy to restore the healthy microbiota in which they will take the vaginal swabs from the mother's vagina, and this is and the neonate is exposed to these vaginal contents. They say that it is exposure through oral, nasal or skin, but this is not approved according by ACOG till now, because this is still in its experimental form and no one has approved it till date. So we should not be doing it unless we get it approval for this study. Results suggest that fetal skin and oral microbiome of seeded infants, they more closely resemble those of vaginally delivered than cesarean section delivered infants. So the results which have shown out of these vaginal seeding, that the microbiome of these kids, they will resemble more of vaginally delivered than C-section delivered, even if they are C-section delivered. So concluding my talk by saying that association between the microbial dysbiosis in infants delivered by C-section and long-term health outcomes is a new field of research, and going forward, it will be necessary to elucidate the mechanisms involved, such as metabolic and immune pathways and microbial function, in order to apply this research to personalized microbiome-based therapies. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Murtaza, for your wonderful talk, especially emphasizing on importance of cesarean section, breastfeeding, and antibiotics in kids. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Dr. Meera?
Am I audible now?
Yeah, very clear.
Yeah, thank you. Okay. Is my screen shared?
Yeah, we can see it clearly.
Okay. So good evening, everyone. Today I'll be talking on the reproductive microbiome, what new has come in it, and how we can modify our reproductive practice, the infertility practice, in terms of the microbiome, and how we can benefit our patients. So basically, what reproductive microbiome is? Yeah. So reproductive microbiome is basically what microbes are there in the reproductive tract. So that is what reproductive microbiome is. That what all microbes are there in the reproductive tract. The way we have our GI microbiome, there are microbes in the GI tract. Similarly, as we know, there are microbes in the reproductive tract also. And now new research is coming up, and which is giving us evidence that if the microbe which is there in the vagina or in the reproductive tract, in case it is altered, it can not only affect the pregnancy in terms of causing the preterm labor or premature labor, preterm premature rupture of membranes, but also it can affect the female in terms of developing diseases like polycystic ovarian syndrome or endometriosis, and also can affect the seminal parameters. And third thing which it can do is, in case a female needs treatment in terms of IVF or IUI or maybe an OITI cycle, it can affect those cycles also. So what changes can we do in our regular practice which can benefit our patients? And also what new has come up is what we'll be discussing now. So as we know that there are a lot of microbes which are there in the reproductive tract. In fact, they are 10 times more than any human cell. And therefore, they're also known as the second genome. So there are a lot of microbes in the human body, and especially in the reproductive tract, which can affect the reproduction process. So first of all, what we need to understand is that it is not that any microbe is bad. We have types of bacteria or types of microbes in the GI tract, in the reproductive tract, which can affect the genitourinary system in terms of fertility. Out of that, we have two main categories. One is lactobacilli and the other one is non-lactobacillus dominant. So in case the microbes which are there are lactobacillus dominant, they make the vaginal pH acidic or the environment acidic, and therefore they prevent any other pathological infection in that system. So in case there are a lot of lactobacilli in the vagina, they make it acidic, the pH acidic, and therefore it prevents the pathological infection in the vagina. So that is how, that is the way it acts, and that is how it is protective against other pathogens. So it can, it is being seen to be helpful in terms of avoiding infections in the vagina, and also it is being seen to be helpful in terms of avoiding any type of preterm premature rupture of membrane because of infections in the female. So vaginal microbe is something which is long being studied, and its good effect is being known since centuries. So whenever we see that the vagina is infected, there are infections in the vagina, we need to treat it, and we do not need to make it completely microbe free. We need to make it microbe friendly in terms of having more number of lactobacilli in the vagina. So we need to treat it. Plus, we need to give the female probiotics also. So as we very well know that in case there are vaginal infections in the female, especially bacterial vaginosis, it can lead to preterm labor and therefore prematurity or preterm premature rupture of membranes. Now next, coming over to the uterus, this we very well know that the uterine cavity is actually sterile. And it is the cervical plug which prevents infections from ascending from the vagina into the uterus. But what happens when copulation happens is, then after coitus, the sperm enters the uterus. It goes through the cervical, So what it does is that it goes through the cervical barrier, the cervical plug, and then it goes into the uterus and therefore in the fallopian tube. And along with it, along with the sperm, also travels the microbes from the vagina. Now, these microbes which travel along with the sperm are not completely bad. Some can lead to infections, but a lot of microbes like the lactobacilli, they are reproduction friendly. They travel along with the sperm. They go till the egg and they help in the fertilization process and also in the implantation process. And it is being said that it can have epigenetic influences also. So microbes are not completely bad. A good microbe like a lactobacilli, if it travels along with the sperm, it is being seen to be helpful in terms of fertilization and therefore the pregnancy process. So it can improve the pregnancy rate after any type of treatment which we give. So as we can see here, normally the uterus is sterile, as the baby travels through the uterus into the vagina and then outside, a lot of microbes come and smear the baby. So as Dr. Murtaza has already talked about it, that not all the microbes which the baby goes through is bad. There are a lot of good microbes also, and yes, some pathogenic ones also, from which we need to save the baby. Now next, coming over to what evidence do we have in terms of these microbes having an effect on the PCOS or on endometriosis. So what new evidence is coming up is that in case the female is infected by, has a lot of lactobacilli in her reproductive tract, then it is protective against PCOS. So now new treatment strategies are coming up in which we are working on these microbes, and females who come to us with PCOS, we are treating them with probiotics and prebiotics. And then we are seeing whether it is having any effect in terms of the testosterone levels, the free androgen index, and the DHEAS levels in the female or not, the SHBG levels or not. And a lot of studies are done on this. And the evidence which has come up is that the duration of treatment which we have given to the female lasts for around 8 to 12 weeks. So in that time, there's not a statistically significant effect in terms of testosterone which has been seen. But when we see the SHBG levels or the PCOS profile, a lot of things are improving. The free androgen index is improving statistically after we are giving prebiotics. So in case we are giving probiotics for a longer time, it can improve the testosterone levels also, because it is having a positive influence, but not, which is not statistically significant. So this is first of all about PCOS, that yes, a lot of evidence is coming up about we treating the PCOS with probiotics and then seeing whether it is having any effect, and the effect is being seen statistically in terms of SHBG levels, in terms of insulin resistance also, yeah, but not in terms of the testosterone levels. Although it is not statistically significant, it is a positive trend. Now next, coming over to endometriosis, as we very well know that endometriosis, there are a lot of pathologies, a lot of the theories, hypothesis which has been put forward, that endometriosis can be caused because of the immune system dysregulation. It can be because of the retrograde menstruation theory. So out of these various hypotheses which has been put forward, one of those is the immune system dysregulation. So these microbes, if we treat them and we have a more of lactobacilli predominant microbial environment, it is being speculated that maybe by modifying the immune regulation, by modifying the microbial environment, we might be able to treat endometriosis or have a new therapeutic strategy by having a new microbial environment. So these are the two things. One is the polycystic ovarian syndrome and the endometriosis. New research is coming over this, and a positive trend towards treatment is being seen, although it is not statistically significant. Now coming over to the infertility part or the ART part. So the as far as the evidence is concerned, the much we know about the microbial composition of the vagina and what effect can it have on the fertility, it is being seen that in case there is a more of pathological infection in the vagina, that is, if the female has more of bacterial vaginosis, then it can have a poor influence on the pregnancy rate in IVF cycle. So this composition of the vaginal microbiome, when we see on the day of embryo transfer in women who are undergoing IVF, we do find that in case there is a lower vaginal microbiome diversity index, then it is correlated with a better live birth rate. That means if there is lesser bacterial vaginosis and more of lactobacilli dominant environment, we do find a positive influence on the live birth rate. Now, there are a lot of ways by which we can have a look on this microbiome. And the two most commonly used technology is the culture or the next generation sequencing. About culture, the thing is, it is not very sensitive. It is specific, but not very sensitive. But with next generation sequencing, it is a very sensitive method, a very sensitive technology which has come up. And it is giving us far more knowledge on the bacterial composition of the vagina, uterus, and the follicular fluid. But the only the thing which we can say that is a negative point about the NGs is its cost. So next, coming over to what study is being done. So there are a lot of studies which are being done in females who have had recurrent implantation failure. And what they found is that in the endometrium, if it is lactobacilli dominated, in that case, they do find a better inference on the pregnancy rate, that there are lesser chances of implantation failure. There are lesser chances of pregnancy being leading to a miscarriage. So lesser miscarriage rate and lesser implantation failure also. In case the endometrium is dominated with the lactobacilli dominant microbe. Now next, coming over to the follicular fluid. So what we do is we at the time of ovum pickup, we take out follicular fluid. So the out of the follicular fluid, the egg is being used up. But what if we are left behind is with the fluid. So that can, on that a lot of studies are going on. We are studying the microorganisms which are there in that follicular fluid and seeing what effect is it having on the egg quality, on the embryo quality, and on the implantation rate also. So what they have seen is that in case the follicular fluid has more of the diversity of microorganisms in it, it is related to an adverse IVF outcome. Now next, coming over to the seminal fluid. So in terms of seminal fluid, there are a lot of studies being done, but there's not a statistically significant relationship which we have found between the abnormal microbiome and the abnormal semen parameters. So it is still uncertain regarding whether if we treat the abnormal semen parameters with probiotics, is it going to have any beneficial effect? But yes, it is not proven. Studies are still going on. We just have to wait and watch. Now, what these probiotics can do? It has been speculated that these probiotics, they can restore a healthy microbiome. They can improve the pro-fertility potential of a female. And also, they might prevent oxidative damage of sperm and therefore may maintain more viability of the sperm and may improve the reproductive outcomes in terms of treatments. So what is the current evidence? Data is currently unclear with respect to the use of probiotics and use of prophylactic antibiotics also in reducing the abnormal pathogens and promoting the growth of lactobacillus species in the female reproductive tract to improve the success of the ART cycle. So we are still unclear, but yes, there is a positive trend which is being seen. And also it is seen that in case of ovarian stimulation, the vaginal microbiome might get altered and therefore they might come up a more role of frozen embryo transfer with time. But we have to wait and watch. So there's a definite relationship between the reproductive tract microbiome as cause of infertility and outcome of ART cycle. The presence of bacterial vaginosis has poor pregnancy rate in ART cycle. Lactobacillus predominance in the reproductive tract has good pregnancy outcome in ART cycle. And NGS is a new technology which has come up, which is giving us more data and more information about the uterine microbiome and the vaginal microbiome. But to date, we still have limited data on this. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Meera, for such a wonderful talk.
Thanks a lot.
So any questions for the webinar?
Ma'am, we have one question from Dr. Sindhu for Dr. Sandhya. That is, can we use Myonestol for adolescents? Is severe hair fall side effects of Myonestol?
We can use myoinositols in adolescents. There is absolutely no contraindication to using them. And those who have alopecia, now there are patients who have adolescents, especially if they have severe hirsutism, that is, alopecia is a manifestation of that. So if they have that, then we should always do it with a consultation from a dermatologist. It's always important to take a dermatology opinion also in this case. But there is no contraindication to myoinositols.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Sure.
Any other questions, Dr. Someshwar?
Ma'am, I don't find any additional questions in the delegates. Only one.
Can I ask a question to Dr. Murtaza? Is it possible for me to ask?
Sure.
Yeah, I was just wondering because he said that preterms and all, they are definitely predisposed to all these problems. But then in preterms, we do not have much of an option but to do a cesarean section. There is really nothing much that we can do in these patients. So in extreme preterm, surfactant therapy for all the other respiratory problems. Is there something which you can do besides the normal armamentarium of treatment?
As I could said in my talk, yeah, you're right, of course. In the case of preterms, we can't do much. Everyone's hands are bound. You as obstetricians and we as neonatologists and pediatricians, our hands are very much bound and we do not have much options. Like the things which we are talking about, like vaginal seeding and the use of probiotics. Now they are trying to develop those probiotics in these preterms, and studies are there, like in a large study in UK, as I told, they are trying it to see how it goes. Let's see. Like as of now, there is no clear-cut proof or anything recommended to do so, to develop that microbiota in those cases. And even okay. I'm not aware of like anything is.
So that is what I thought, because you know when we give, like normally for adults we give antibiotics, we go give probiotics, we give so many other things, but for a preterm it becomes very challenging for us also, because we can only treat the mother with those kind of antibiotics, bacterial vaginosis, whatever it is, but we do not know what to do with the neonate, and then the pediatricians also have a tough time. Especially there are certain antibiotics, of course, we know, like Augmentin and all, to be avoided, they cause NEC. But besides that, many of the gynecologists are not aware of what they should do to, you know, counter this. So I was looking forward to some tips from you. So I'm very happy to get enlightened on this topic.
Yeah. As you were saying, Augmentin is a known drug which causes NEC, even maternal cocaine exposure.
Yeah.
Because it's not a drug, but it has been seen to have chances of NEC in those preterms. It increases the likelihood, along with tough feeding, of course.
Right.
Is a risk factor for NEC. Other drugs are there, but I will really have to look into the literature.
Yeah. Because this is something, you know, which we've seen very commonly. Many gynecologists also are not so aware that Augmentin can cause so many problems. Okay. And we land up with, you know, babies in the NICU with this problem. So we've made it a conscious effort to tell people that please, try and withhold Augmentin as far as possible.
Right, ma'am, right.
Great talk. Thank you.
Ma'am, we have other questions. From Dr. Sindhu, can you quote IDN stats for one in ISCS kids? I think statistics for the ISCS kids in India. I think this is for the Murtaza sir.
I couldn't get the question, sorry.
Can you quote IDN statistics for ID? I think ideal statistics for ISCS kids in India.
I'm nothing aware. I'm not at all aware of anything like this. Sorry, I'm sorry for that.
Okay, sir. Can you skip that? And I think there is one more question from Dr. Geeta. Can ionestrol combine with other medicine like Diamet? I think this question is for Dr. Sandhya, ma'am.
Okay, fine. See, there are a lot of combinations which have been coming in. In the recent years, we have seen so many with the melatonins, with acetylcysteines, ionositols. In fact, there are combinations of metformin along with other drugs also. So there is definitely, 1 year or 2 years back, there was a advisory against using too many combination drugs. So at that point of time, we were just waiting for how these manifest and what is the efficacy. But right now, I would say use combinations very judiciously, except the known combinations of metformin with other drugs are quite safe. But if you're using too many drugs in one, then you have to just reassess whether the benefits are so many. Even a single drug alone can give you the benefits, but having so many combinations, especially enzymes and so many other preparations, melatonin nowadays is coming in a big way. It has been documented to be very useful. But I would say just, you know, see, individualize the treatment, which patient is going to fit in where. You can't give one patient which is not having those kind of symptomatology a drug which has a combination which is not going to be useful to her. So that is the only thing. But combinations, by and large, they have no problems. It is safe.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes. Payal, do you have any question you would like to think will benefit the audience?
Yeah, especially nowadays, ma'am, because of the cervical cancer, increased rate in cervical cancer. I wanted to ask Dr. Meera if microbiome and probiotics play any role for patients who come with wide discharge. So, any way it can help those patients? Can you unmute yourself?
Yeah. Am I audible now?
Yeah. Yeah.
So in terms of cervical cancer, I did not see any study or any evidence supporting the prevention of cervical cancer with the use of probiotics. But yes, this is it will be quite interesting for me to go into deeper details of this, and maybe something I can find.
Payal, if I could answer that partly, if you permit me. I would like to say that we had a lot of conferences with oncologists recently. And when we were looking at menstrual hygiene, so what they emphasized is that when we are addressing the issue of menstrual hygiene, we have seen that worldwide the incidence of cervical cancers has reduced, where the menstrual hygiene level is very good. So they have definitely found a correlation between the status of the vaginal flora and the incidence of cervical cancer. As we all know, cervical cancer is linked with HPV. So it is basically the HPV virus. But that also, all these things can thrive only in a milieu which is conducive to their growth. So if you are taking care of menstrual hygiene and if you are having an incidence of cervical cancer coming down, then definitely I would say that, you know, if you are going to strengthen the bacterial flora in the vagina, so we are going to look at lesser of infections, and definitely we are going to, the lesser the infections, the lesser the cervical epithelium, the squamous lining is eroded. And then definitely any cancer is, it's a metaplasia, then it goes to dysplasia, and then it goes to hyperplasia. So I think we can look into that.
Yeah, yeah, very true, ma'am. But as far as I have gone through, till now, there's no study as such or no evidence as such on the prevention of cervical cancer or the maintenance of... in the vaginal flora, or to go into deeper details of this.
Okay. So while treating a patient of wide discharge, like usually we give them antifungal, then metrogyl or tinidazole, and then followed by, some vaginal pessaries. So do we need to give them some probiotic, or ask them, at least to have curd? That is what, if the patients are poor, I usually ask them to have a lot of curds for that. So is it correlated, all these things, ma'am?
Dr. Payal, yes, this I did find that, yes, they are using probiotics in females with PID. And it is for the reproduction, if you look at, for the reproductive ability of the female or for the reproduction status of the female to improve in terms of fertility, yes, it is showing benefit. In case of PID, if we are giving them probiotics, there's some evidence in terms of improvement in the fertility status of the female, but not in the prevention of cervical cancer as such. till now. But yes, quite interesting for us to look into it. But for PID females, yes, it does have a role.
It definitely prevents recurrence of repeated cervical infections, definitely. If you give probiotics, what happens is sometimes patients come at least every alternate month with white discharge, you know, and then they say especially itching and pruritus and all. So if you're giving a probiotic, then the rationale is that the integrity of the, like I said, it is intact for a longer time. So it definitely prevents a recurrence.
Okay, thank you. So, any more questions, Dr. Someshwar?
Ma'am, there's a one question that was for Dr. Murtaza. That is regarding the statistics for lower segment cesarean section kids in India regarding this dysbiosis.
Yeah, the statistics which I gave you was NFHS-4 data, which I just showed in my first slide. It said that in the, like, the latest one is of 15-16. It has said that total number of cesarean sections have increased up to 17.2% of all the deliveries. Whereas in the West, it is much higher. It's up to the tune of 30%. The CDC was giving a data of 30%. With regards to dysbiosis, like the statistics of dysbiosis in these kids, I couldn't find any RCT or any good study from our country. Maybe I didn't search the literature much. But as of now, I couldn't find any literature from our country of, like, which I can quote. We have all the studies from the West regarding this dysbiosis and C-section.
Thank you, sir. There are no more questions from the delegates.
Thank you, our speakers, for such wonderful and informative talks. A special thanks to Shield Connect and Dr. Someshwar for providing the platform. I referred the Shield Connect YouTube channel many times to hear the doctors on various topics for latest updates. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much. And ma'am, this webinar recording will be available on our website as mentioned in the start of the webinar itself. So happy viewing to all the viewers, and also we look forward for many more webinars from you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you. Thank you all.